Hi there, this is GroovyNG, and today I've got a crazy fun video to go through. I'm going to delve a little bit into the history of drum and bass, and then I'm going to be going through and doing a technical breakdown of Good Looking Records and LTJ Bookham, and really getting to some of the techniques involved in making intelligent drum and bass music. In the late 1980s, dance music in the UK has started to evolve from house to acid house. Then, in the early 1990s, through record labels such as Suburban Bass, acid house started to evolve into breakbeat and hardcore. One of the driving factors to the evolutions of dance music at this time was the introduction of hardware samplers, or cheaper hardware samplers, in the late 80s and early 90s. These included the Akai S900, which was brought out in 1986 and is a 12-bit sampler with a variable sample rate of 7.5 kHz to 40 kHz. The Akai S950, which is a very famous classic sampler and people love that crunchy 12-bit sound, was also introduced in 1988. The Roland S770 came out in 1990, and this was one of the first samplers to support 16-bit stereo sampling up to 48 kHz. And finally, a notable word mentioned is the Ensoniq EPS 16 Plus, which also came out in 1990, and this had a sample rate of 11.2 kHz to 44.6 kHz. Alongside the introduction of these cheaper hardware samplers also came cheaper home computers. The Amiga 1000 was released in 1985 and cost just over $1,000, which was an advancement on the very popular Commodore 64. And then the Atari ST-1040 came out in 1986 and was just under $1,000. The Atari and the Amiga were a lot cheaper than other computer equivalents at that time, such as the Macintosh 2, which was released in 1987 for about $5,500, which is the equivalent to $13,000 today. Furthermore, there was also advancements in music production software, as we see the birth of a number of DAWs that are still very popular to this day. Cubase was released in 1992 on Atari, and eMagic Notator was also released in 1993 on Atari and Mac. Octomed was released in 1989, which was a very popular tracker at that time on Amiga, and Pro Tracker was released in 1991, which was another very popular tracker also released on Amiga.
Amiga speaking.
Digi Design Tools was released in 1989 on Mac, and that would eventually turn into Pro Tools, and then eMagic Logic 1.7 was released in 1994, and that would eventually become Logic X. One of the main advantages to all these advancements in computer technology and in hardware samplers is that they made electronic music production a lot more accessible to home producers and hobbyists.
I think it's brilliant because not everyone can play, say, a keyboard or play a guitar or play drums or whatever. So in the days when there weren't samplers, you had to have a band and be skilled in a particular instrument to make music. Well, now you don't. Well, that's brilliant.
From 1990 to 1992, we can really start to hear this transition from breakbeat into jungle and drum and bass through releases by artists such as Rebel MC. In 1991, LTJ Bookham released Demon's Theme. And in 1992, Doc Scott released Here Come the Drums. In In this time, we start to see the real foundations of drum and bass being laid by the launch of pioneering record labels such as Moving Shadow and Ram Records and Metalheads. LTJ Bookham founded Good Looking Records in 1991, which was specifically focused on a rolling, jazzy type of atmospheric drum and bass, also known as intelligent drum and bass.
Early 1990, I made Demon's Theme. And Demon's Theme was to be the start of Good Looking Records in 1991.
It featured a number of tracks by himself, as well as releases from artists such as Seba and Blue Marten, who were also making amazing music at that time.
Hi, we're Blue Marten. My name's Chris. This is my partner Leo. We signed to LTJ Bookham Good Looking Records.
Whether you're into the more modern and exciting upfront styles of drum and bass, you can't argue that this rolling, intelligent, jazzy style of old-school Good Looking Records tracks are just incredible, and there's just so much groove and vibe in these tunes, and I've really loved going back through and listening to all these old records for this tutorial. And for me, there's nothing better than being sat on a beach with a couple of your mates and just listening to some of these rolling drum and bass tracks. Today, the internet has opened up so many places and ways to gather samples, and right here on YouTube is an absolute goldmine, and I will share some of my favourite places to collect samples in the comments of this video. Now, sampling is not really something that I can teach you that easily. It's something you've really just got to do on a lazy Sunday afternoon, and you just got to get yourself a big pot of coffee and just sit there for a couple of hours and go and find loads of cool little chunks of tracks and get them all in a nice playlist.
A lazy Sunday afternoon in North London, and a young computer genius is working at home.
But one thing I do really like to do when I go sampling is actually to come in with a list of elements that I'm looking for. This is very similar to having a shopping list of just different things like effects and pads and drums, and just try and fill out all these different categories rather than just randomly collecting lots of chops. I'm listening for specific elements which I'm looking to fill out in my list. So I'm just very quickly going to go through some of the elements that I actually got for this track. And I didn't use all of these examples in my song, but these were just some of the samples that I collected for this track.
Matters not how straight the gate, how punishment charged the scroll. I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul.
With regards to the drum breaks used in these early Good Looking Records releases, the drum programming is actually very simple. The focus seems much more on creating a rolling groove than having crazy programmed amens flying around everywhere. Here, it's literally as simple as just taking a drum break from a track and cutting it into a nice 2 or 4 bar loop, and then pitching it up to the key of your track and just repeating it over and over again. And so I've done that with the Hot Pants break here, So it's literally as simple as just looping the drum break around and around. But one thing you've got to pay attention to is the processing. So one thing I've done here, and this is quite a neat little trick, is you can see I've put all of these slice markers in, and I didn't actually need that to make it loop perfectly, but the reason I did it is because I wanted to put a bit of a reverb on the snare, but not on the rest of the track. So what you can do is, if you put all these slice markers in, and I've just put them, you can see at sort of every other beat here, and then you hit right click and you go slices, and you can render slices to a phrase. Now I can trigger this break from the phrase. And so what I'm doing here is actually just triggering this phrase over and over again, and I'm triggering the phrase to play. But what I've done in the effects section is I have gone and I've got the snares channel. So what I've done is I've played this break and I've been looking at where these hits are, and I can see that's a snare there and that's another snare there, and then I've got the effects one is blank, and then for all the effects, all the snares, sorry, I've sent them all to their own effects lane. So if I go to the effects, you can see the snares are all going here, and then I've sent that lane, I've used a send effect. So if you come down here, you can just type send, and then I've got a send effect, and I'm sending that to a reverb channel with 100% wet on, and I'm just using a little plate here with a very short decay time. Now the reason I'm using this send effect is actually I don't want to change the level of the snare in the mix or in that break. I just want to add a bit of reverb to it. And if I put the reverb directly onto this snares channel, I would then start to change the level as I brought up the reverb. So it just made more sense to me there to use a send effect. But if I take it off, yeah, so the effect here is really just adding a little bit of decay to that snare and just helping it ring out a little bit longer, and I thought that helped with the overall groove of the break. Now, whilst the programming is very simple, I did do a fair bit of processing, and I'm using my two favourite plugins here, which is Decimort and the RX950, and I think they're both, sometimes a combination of both of them is a really great way to get that vintage sound on your drums. And so what I've done to start with is, if I just sort of pull out some of the things on this chain, we can leave that gain. I've started by using a transient master, and I'm just pulling in some of the shaker sound and the decay on the samples, and just making everything a lot tighter. And then I'm using Decimort, and I'm probably smashing this quite a lot. So I'm pulling down the sample rate, I am doing a bit of preamp drive, and I've got some of the filters working as well. I'm also using an RX950, doing more sample rate reduction and pulling the filter down as well. And I'm monitoring this breakout. So if we look at this on a frequency spectrum, I'm really just pulling away all of this stuff here, which is kind of above 7 kilohertz or 8 kilohertz. I'm really crunching everything down and just getting rid of any harsh digital tops in this break. For the Curtis Blow break, I've just got a limiter on here, but I did run this through the EMU, and I used the filters and the sample rate reduction and the bit crusher. So I did a very similar process in an analog way for the do break, and then I did the Hot Pants one in a more digital way and used emulation plugins to achieve a very similar effect. In terms of the effects used on the drums, they were actually very limited in those days in what they could do. And a lot more of the focus in that style was around groove and less around all these crazy effects that we hear, like comb filtering and things like that, that are present in modern day music. But one very common trick that is very popular actually in hip hop, which we see used a lot in this style of drum and bass, is these long filtered sections where you will have the filter open for a section and then it'll actually close on another section. And in hip hop, this is done usually to give some change from the verse to the chorus. When you've got a sample looping, you can pull down the filter and that will make space for the rapper to come in. Send yourself to come in love. Things you do.
Ladies loving my music is like some sex shit. Niggas trying to grip up my mic like it's a dead.
In my track, I've emulated this by pulling down the filter in this breakdown section, and I'm pulling all the high frequencies out of this pad, and then I'm making space for the speech vocals to come in. But one thing just to note here is when you want to do automation on third-party plugins, you can't actually right-click the parameter here and change that to record it. What you got to do is actually open the plugin in this section and then find the parameter, and then you right click down here and you can see now it starts to change, and I can record this, I can live record it as I play the sample.
When we release our fingers from grip of hostility and allow the pure air to soothe our calm.
In the same way that we see the drums being built around a core loop of a drum break, there's also quite often a loop of a sample which the track is centered around. And quite often they have this sample looping, which can be an arp or a pad, and then they're stacking elements and building on top of that core foundation of the track. Rather than using more typical pop style arrangements such as verses and choruses and bridges, these old D&B tracks often feature really long intros and then sometimes just very contrasting sections, like a few different chunks of the track, and the tracks can be really long. I tried to emulate that with my song and I think I got to 7 minutes or something, but it's really about letting the track really groove and roll out and having a few contrasting sections together rather than these shorter chunks that we're used to now with modern music. In terms of putting this together in Renoise, it's actually really simple, the arrangement. I'm literally just muting sections at different points and bringing elements in and out, and I'm not using any crazy effects, I'm not really using any fills. There's a few little things happening at some of the drops and that's it. It's just keeping everything very simple and stripped back and just letting it all groove. But one thing I did do when I made this track is that I really built up a 64 bar section and just put all the elements in that. So in the beginning, I would just have a loop going like this and just keep building and building and building everything in it. And one thing you've got to remember is that you don't actually need all these elements to work together. But it's quite nice to go back to the thing I was talking about before, is that you have a central sample, and if all your other samples are working with that sample, then you can sort of fit them all together. If they're all in the same key and they're all working with that sample, then everything starts to gel together. And you might end up with two or three different sections from this initial idea. I thought that would be work really well for an intro section. And then I had this pad as well here. With regards to vocals, a lot of these early jungle tracks feature samples from movies and films and radio cuts and other people's records. And this is because the legality of sampling was still very vague at that time, and people could just kind of take samples where they needed them and off they went.
When I say go
on then.
In his groundbreaking track Horizons, LTJ Bookham actually used a speech from Bill Clinton's inauguration in 1993 by Maya Angelou.
Each new hour holds new chances for new beginnings. The horizon leans forward, offering you space to place new steps of change.
The only thing to really note about sampling people's speeches is just that you can cut them up and piece together little different sections of the track to make it fit or make it make sense with your song. And that's what I did with the speech in my track. So if I actually show you the whole speech here in Twisted Wave, I've taken this little chunk from the start here.
When we release our fingers from fists of hostility and allow the pure air to cool our palms.
And then I've gone to the end here and I've found another little chunk.
Every man and every woman can live freely without sanctimonious piety and without crippling fear.
And the idea for me is just to make the whole thing make sense in the track. And then in Renoise, I'm just triggering this at the same point in each bar. So I've gone a little bit offbeat for where it's triggered. And I think I really did that so that this last point, when it triggers, it leads me nicely into the drop.
Without sanctimonious piety.
Another very common technique is to use African vocals or tribal chants in your track. These pair especially well with ethnic percussion, which is very popular in jungle music, and they also can give you this otherworldly epic sense to your tracks. So for my track, what I actually did is I had this, if I reverse this back, I had this chant that I wanted to use, but it wasn't really working. So I just flipped it round into reverse. And so I've got that sounding pretty cool there. And then I've used an RX here. I'm definitely doing a lot of filtering there and pulling away the high frequencies again, which I'm doing on pretty much every track in this project. I'm doing a bit of LFO to filter just to give it a little bit of movement, and then obviously lots of delay. So I'm using a really healthy slow delay and a big reverb with a really high wet rate, so 50% wet there, and a long reverb tail. And yeah, I've got it sat quite far back in the mix, but it seems to be working where it is. The Finally, some classic vocals from artists such as Aretha Franklin or Shaka go down swimmingly in these tracks with lots of reverb and delay and push quite far back in the mix. So before I start jumping into more aspects of this track, I think it's really worth just going over the processing again and getting this old school vintage sound in your tracks. As I've been saying, it's really about removing harsh digital tops and giving some saturation and warmth to the low mids and the low end. And I'm doing this with saturation, with bit crushing, with sample rate reduction, and with filtering are my main tools. When LTJ Bookham first started producing, he was using pure hardware, with an Akai S950 giving a lot of that 12-bit crunch to the sound. Bookham also used an Akai S1000, which is another classic Akai, being one of the first to reproduce stereo samples at 16-bit. In order to emulate this style, I've been using the RX950 and Decimal 2, and I actually love these plugins. And if you want to support my channel, there's actually a link in the description, which is an affiliate link to those plugins. If you want to grab them, we'll both benefit off them, because I really do think they're both amazing plugins and probably the best you can get to emulate these vintage samplers. Alongside using plugins to emulate some of the old school crunch of the hardware samplers, we can also use synth design to emulate that vintage warbling detuned sound. These detuned lead sounds are very reminiscent of synths such as the Juno 60 and the Yamaha DX7. In this example, I'm going to use the Digitone, which is a product made by Electron, and I actually love this synth for achieving this style of sound. Okay, so here we are in the Digitone, and for any of you who don't know, this is a lovely little FM synth made by Electron. Now, I'm not going to go too much into the synthesis here, because I really want to show you a couple of cool LFO tricks, but I've really got it's a shiny style patch, and then when I bring up the mod wheel, it's turning into a more of a sawtooth, like a buzzy saw patch, and so it's nice and mellow, and then I can increase the intensity with the mod wheel. Now, firstly, I'm just going to go and turn up the delay a little bit, and I'm using a dotted eighth note delay. And then I've got my reverb settings. I haven't got them too high, so I might turn up the reverb a little bit, and I'm going to pull out this amp so the note rings out nice and long. Cool. Getting there. Let's go turn the mod wheel up. Maybe I've got a little bit too much delay. Maybe we'll not have that too much. So I'm just kind of perfecting the sound a little bit. What I really want to show you is in this LFO page, and you can apply this to any synth you like, but it's a really cool trick to get really effective detuning and warbling sounds. And it's quite simple. What we're really going to do is we're going to go on mode, and we actually want this on free mode. And I'm going to use a random waveform, and then I'm just going to apply this to tuning. So pitch all is what it's called in the Digitone. And then you can hear, as I turn up this depth even a little bit, and it can get really unstable very quickly, so we're going to use very low values. But actually, I'm going to take this BPM value down, which is the multiplier, so that would be the speed. Sounding quite cool. It's still moving a lot, but you can hear instantly. And it just brings it to life, having that instability to the sound and that random pitch modulation. And what's actually happening here, if I go into the setup, yeah, what you can actually see here is this play mode is on poly, and not only is it letting me play polyphonically, where I can play lots of notes at the same time, but also the LFO is polyphonic, and that means that each note I trigger will have its own LFO value. And what that really is that they'll all be slightly out of tune. Every note you play, even if you play them all at the same time, they will all have that little bit of instability. And that's why it sounds really cool. So that's a very common trick, but a way we can advance this is actually to use another LFO. And here what I'm going to do is set this LFO, and the target for this one is going to be the first LFO. So what I've actually done, I think, is set them the wrong way around. So let me just copy this. This was on LFO page 2. I've got to copy this to page 1. And then on LFO page 2 now, I can use the depth of LFO 1, set that as my source or my destination. And now I can modulate this. But what I want to do is modulate this one really slowly. So I'm going to pull the BPM right down to 1. And let's just have a little subtle LFO for now. Okay, so we've got our BPM really low, and then I'm also going to pull this way, way down as well. Just to like a really, really low value, and then we're going to have quite a low depth again. You can see it's still going to do a bit crazy things, but if we just have it really subtly again. Too much? There's loads of instability to the sound here. And so we've just got these two LFOs working subtly together, and the second LFO is just going to very subtly change the first one every now and again, and that's just going to give you more instability to your sounds and more randomness when you're playing chord progressions and things like that. So one final trick just to finish this all off is actually to come into this setup. So here we can go into the setup, and what I'm going to do, usually when I hit a note and I hit the pitch bend, it's set to 2 here, so it's going to pitch bend 2 semitones. Which is very cool. But actually, I can take this away, and then I can set parameters to be the pitch bend. And what I'm going to do is actually set this to be LFO 1 depth again. And so essentially, when I'm going to hit this pitch wheel now, it's going to slightly adjust that random envelope again, that random LFO again. And if I increase this again, maybe that's way too much. Maybe we want to go 0.4. That's a little bit too much. I kind of want the max level to be the most I want to do it. And let's go plus 30, plus 25 maybe. So I can just add a little bit more instability by pulling up this pitch wheel. And why I love doing this is because I can have the mod wheel doing all the filter stuff. And you can just add those little bits of instability in, and it's lovely because it snaps back. So you can just add a little. Okay, cool. So one final trick I'm here is actually to do something quite similar, and we're sending an LFO to pitch here. But actually, what I'm doing this time is I'm using a sine wave. Now, a sine wave will give you a more vibrato style sound. And what I'm doing is I'm using a fade here. So what we're going to have is the sound start fairly normal, and then as the sound progresses, it's going to start to vibrato more and more. And it just adds to the more the sound sustain, the more detuned they're going to become. If I add a little bit more to this effect here, it'll become a lot more obvious. So maybe I want a little bit more of a fade here. Really great vintage sounds. And so those are just a few little LFO tricks, basically modulating pitch with a few different ways and a few different varieties for getting those cool vintage warbling sounds out of your synths. Another very common technique is to use the pitch wheel to create these bending lead effects, and these sound great at the start of new sections and really help grab the listener's attention. In my track, I did this on the digitone, and I resampled out this lead, which is, I think it's just a single note, and I'm pulling down the pitch wheel, two semitones, I think I've got it set on, and it creates this really nice warbling, pitchy, detuned sound. It sounds a little bit ominous, but if I play you the build up to that section, I think it really helps kickstart the idea that a new section is happening. Probably the most recognisable or featured aspect of intelligent drum and bass is the lush pad sounds. These were often sampled from other records and synths and then given movement with filters and layered to help with the groove. So there's a few cool things in Renoise I want to show you with regards to this pad. Firstly, this is actually a sample from this song by T. Bastow. Which is really cool, and there's a few things that I really love about this. One thing, if you listen to the sample, it actually has an arp in it, as well as a few melodic notes. It's got a bit of a Stranger Things low arp, and then it's got some a high delayed sort of motif as well, which plays in the pad. Now, what's so cool about that is if I just play this, you can hear that all the extra elements. Speed up as I pitch up the pad, and that's just what happens with samplers. When you pitch something up, it speeds up, but it's really cool having those extra elements as well as the pad, the little melodic notes and the ARP in there, because they all get pitched up as well. And especially when you're doing like chromatic movements, everything is going with the pad, and you can get really complex sounding pads that are actually quite simple because everything is embedded in the pad. And we will make one of these in a second. But there's a few more things I want to show you in Renoise first. So yes, the original pad is really cool, but I've also layered it up quite a lot. And I've done quite a cool trick here where what I've done is I created four effects chains. So each of these instruments, which I've stacked all on top of each other, is going to a different effects chain. And at the end of each effects chain, I have just got a gain plugin here. And I've called it mute, but it's actually just a gain plugin like this. It's called Gainer, and I've just put the gainer on nothing and then called it mute like this. And so I can toggle these mutes on and off, and they're going to mute the different layers of the track. So if I sort of layer this up one by one and I mute all the elements bar my main track, so I've got the main sample here, and then I've got a saw layer which I've layered on top of that, which is filling out some of that high end here. And if I have them both going, it's quite low in the mix, but it definitely comes through and it just has a little bit more movement going there. And then I've got this this creak sound, which is very low in the mix. And then I've also got a frying sound of me frying some bacon in the morning. And that's really just like a white noise layer. But what I am doing with these texture layers is I'm bandpassing them, and then they're both moving as well, very subtly, in slightly different frequency ranges. I've got this LFO to filter cutoff, and it's just very slowly modulating around. And so everything's just moving a little bit. I'm also doing that with this other pad. I'm bandpassing and just controlling the high frequencies, but just adding a little bit movement in all of these layers. And it's all about the sum of the parts. And so whilst the original pad is great, I wanted some of that high-end frequency spectrum to fill out. If you listen to Atmospherical Jubilancy, which is a track by LTJ Bookham, if you listen to the pad in that, it's got all of this high pitch, crunchy noise layer on top of the pad, and it really fills out the space. And I wanted to do something similar with my track. And if I take all the mutes off, that's the clean sample. And that's with all the layers, and it just sounds thicker and bigger and brighter, and that was the real goal that I was going for there. So one cool thing I did, which was actually a bit of a failed idea, is I tried layering on that original pad idea in Logic and just chucking lots of different sounds on it and then bringing it back into Renoise and seeing if that would work. And what this essentially is I got all these examples here. So I've layered some vocals in it there. I layered some keys in that one. And I was just trying it. And so what I would do in Renoise is come to this pad patch and just duplicate this whole thing. So I've got this thing called Pad Enhance, I called it. So just duplicate the track over with Command D. And then I think I just Command and copy them all over, mute these ones, and then you can just change all of these. And so I then duplicate this pad patch here, and then I just need to change the instrument number. So change that to F. Let's go down a page, change to F, change to F, and then I can change all of these to F as well. So now all of these are triggering a new instrument. And what I can then do, if I go back to the start, is actually come into this instrument, come to the pad layer, and then drag this layered new version of the pad back into Renoise. And it had a loop on it, I think, something like this. And I was just testing this out, and I thought it was a really cool idea because it's going to follow the same pitching and everything I did in my track, but it's now got new layers to the pad. And for whatever reason, I didn't end up using it, but I did think it was a very cool idea. So we're in Logic now, and I quickly just want to show you how to create one of these lush pads from scratch. And I think it's really just about layering and stacking things on top of each other and really filling out the space. So for the MIDI, I'm really focusing on major and minor ninth and seventh chords. And that's kind of the focus of the notes. And you can see here, I've also done a little bit of strumming. So like a natural piano player would strum a little bit. I'm not always having all the notes hitting just straight on the one. And so this is actually a digitone patch. And this is the sort of core of the sound. So the core layer, which has that nice old Juno sound to it, with a little bit of pitch warbling happening. Okay, so the next thing is I've got a layer from an M1, and I think this is a brighter layer here. So you can hear it's got a lot less of that low mid range, and this is doing more of the sparkly and ethereal stuff in the top end. And I've got an EQ pulling out low end, and then a bit of chorusing, reverb, and this is doing some more pitch warbling, this tape delay in Logic. But together, it really starts to fill out the frequency spectrum a bit more. And then I think this is just a piano-ish. So this is just for some nice notes in there, thickening it up even more. And if I'm correct, I actually used I've got a low pass filter here doing a bit of movement. So filter movement is always a great way to just humanize pad sounds, and just having a filter slowly modulating with an LFO. And I've just copied the exact MIDI down from each of those tracks. But for this one, this is now the ARP sound, I think. And I'm using a TAL here. If I copy this, I'm modulating the filter with this modulator in Logic, so more filter modulation. And I'm really controlling the hit of all those little notes, keeping it nice and staccato. And I'm using an ARP plugin, which is really great here, by Exepha, who also makes Serum. And I think I actually was experimenting either going with a 16th note and it's not the craziest ARP pattern, but it's something that just has a little bit more than just going straight up and down in triads. And then finally, I have this little piano, and this has got loads of delay on it. This is a super weird delay plugin that has taken me years and years to get around. I think I bought this like 12 years ago and I've never used it. But finally, I feel like I've learned enough about music that I can get my head around a delay plugin. So ignore the controls, but I think it's just doing a half note delay. With a really long feedback, a really high feedback rate. So it's really ringing out for the whole sample. But if I combine all of this stuff together now, sounding really nice. Okay, and then finally I've got just a few more texture and Atmos layers. I've got some birds and a sunny day, which is just a texture noise from a recording, like a field recording, and then some more of that sizzling white noise style noise. And all of that's in the background, and then it's all running, and all I've got on the main bus is another Decimal, doing a little bit of filter, just pulling some of the harsh top end out again, and doing a little bit of sample rate reduction. So it's sounding really nice, and I actually rendered down a few different versions, just testing out ARP speeds and just different movements in the pads. Another very important element in this style of drum and bass is these little bits of magic dust and ear candy that's sprinkled over the tracks. These really help accentuate the groove and give lovely little elements for your ears to pick up on. So in Renoise, I've done this quite a lot in this track and just added these little elements in. And so here I've got sort of a very heavily delayed few melodic notes here, just playing in the key of my track. Just with really long delay times and lots of reverb on all of this stuff. And then I've got another very similar element around here I can show you. So I'm actually here just rolling my hand along the keys, and because I made this song in E flat minor, it's basically all the black notes, so I just roll my fingers across the keys until I get something that sounds good. And I've got another element here I've done with some chimes and bells, and it just gives a little bit more life to these sections. Yeah, so that's really it for me today. I really love going back over all this amazing music from Good Looking Records and delving into all the techniques of LTJ Bookham and this intelligent style of drum and bass. It's something that I actually really love, probably the style of drum and bass I love the most, so it's been a really fun one for me, and I hope you've enjoyed it too. Anyway, that's all for me today. Peace.
Right about now, sounds you've been waiting for, people on the dance floor. Make some noise for the sound of the LTJ Bookham inside the house of progression sessions. This is how we do. This is how we're coming in.
fingers from fists of hostility and allow the pure air to soothe our hearts. Every man and every woman can live freely without sanctimonious piety and without crippling fear.